Hi, everyone. I'm about to start. So today I'm going to talk to you about Shinjuku, a system that we built that allows us to schedule small tasks at microsecond scale with interrupts, but without having to sacrifice the tail latency of applications. And this is a joint work with my collaborators and advisor at Stanford and MIT. And this is not a networking talk at all, so you should expect a systems call, and it's much more academic than the other talks in the conference. It's not evaluated like in a large-scale deployment or in a, like in a real system. So to start, let's see why we care about the tail latency as a metric. What is important for us? So data center workloads have a high fan out, and therefore intermediate servers have to wait for all of the backend nodes to finish execution before they can send a reply out back to the users. So the user experience latency is heavily affected by the backend node that takes the longest to finish. And that's why in this work, we focus on these individual leaf nodes with a goal of minimizing the tail latency there by doing a better scheduling. So, you know, modern hardware like a PCIe connected NICs and switches and applications like key value stores and in memory databases allow for microsecond level execution times. But achieving those in actual system is not easy because Linux operates at the millisecond scale. So we might have millisecond level delays for scheduling and context switching. We need to move often between the kernel space and the user space. And also the network stack is quite thick. We need to call many functions before we actually access a packet from the network. And that's exactly why the community started to build specialized operating systems that bypass the Linux kernel and directly expose the hardware to user space. So the employee optimizations, such as polling for incoming packets instead of using interrupts, and executing the request to completion, basically foregoing scheduling. So in such systems, there is usually a queue on each CPU or core, and packets that come in the system are hashed at the NIC and then assigned to one of the per core queues. And we call this a type of architecture a DFCFS because we have distributed queues and FCFS scheduling within each queue. And this is used by libraries like DPDK and systems like Kozyrakis. But it has an issue. It's likely that imbalances appear between these queues. So it's possible that the packet that comes in the system is assigned to the queue of a busy core, even though there are other idle cores in the system. And the easiest solution to this issue is to simply have a single queue where all the requests are going in there and then assigned to one of the workers on demand according to some scheduling policy. And we call this architecture a CFCFS because we have a single queue and FCFS scheduling within the queue. Another solution to that is to have a layer of work stealing on top of a DFCFS. And that's a system called Zygos. I'm sorry that's doing that. But as we'll see later on the talk, this has its own issues. Okay, so now we saw that we have these two queuing architecture scheduling policies. Let's see how they perform for different workloads. And here we use a simulation to compare the performance of DFCFS and CFCFS without modeling additional overheads. So in this case, we have a light-tailed exponential workload with a mean of 1 microsecond, and which is characteristic of a key value store where most of the requests are homogeneous get and put queries. And here, in case you haven't seen a figure like that before, we have a latency load figure. On the horizontal axis, we have the load of the application, in the vertical one, the tail latency. And basically, the lower the latency, for the higher the load, the better the performance. Or in other words, we want the latency to explode as far to the right as possible. So in this case, we see that for DFCFS, the latency starts to go up at a low load of about 0.6, where one here is the maximum load the system can support theoretically, while a CFCFS is almost optimal as it goes to more than 0.9 before it starts exploding. But if we move to a highly variable workload, one where most of the requests are very small, but there are a few long ones, which is characteristic of a key value store that can support scan queries, for example, as well, on top of the get and put queries, we see that FCFS is not enough. A DFCFS is basically unusable, even for low loads, while even a CFCFS latency starts to go up at a low load. And the reason this is happening is because the higher the load, they're more likely that all the cores are hogged by long requests. So a short request that comes to the system will be stuck behind the long ones in the queue and the cores that are executing. And there is a very simple solution to this issue, to be able to context switch between the different requests in the queue and the system so that we give the small ones the opportunity to execute before the long ones finish their own execution. Okay, let's say we do that at a Linux timescales. So we context switch between the requests every one a millisecond. So here we see that the performance is identical as that of a CFCFS. We do not gain any additional benefit. And the reason this is happening is because the service time of even the longer request of the workload is so small that they're basically never interrupted. But if we're able to context switch super, super fast, let's say every 5 microseconds, for example, we can achieve almost optimal performance even for this highly variable application. Okay, so we saw that for effective scheduling for tail latency, we need to have a single queue, some interrupts, and also scheduling policies that match each workload characteristics. Because, for example, we saw that for the light-tailed exponential one, a CFCFS is enough, but for the heavy-tailed one, the highly variable one, we need interrupts. And it's easy to do all of this in simulation, but in order to do them in a real system at microsecond scale, we need to have a queue that supports millions of accesses each second by a large number of cores. We need to be able to interrupt as often as every 5 microseconds that we saw in the simulation, and also we need to have super lightweight scheduling policies. And that's exactly why we built a Shinjuku, a single address space operating system that achieves all of these goals by dedicating a core for scheduling and queue management, by leveraging hardware support for virtualization in order to implement very low overhead interrupts, by implementing a very fast context switching in user space, and finally by matching the scheduling policy to the task execution time and target latency. So now we will see how Shinjuku works and the design of it. So Shinjuku consists of a number of worker cores that execute the application code, a dispatcher which handles all the scheduling and the queue management, and we use this dispatcher in order to avoid the contention for a single queue and to make decisions based on full knowledge of the system, because it knows what exactly is executing on each of the worker cores. So we also have a networking subsystem that terminates the connections and can be anything from a dedicated core, any network stack, smart NIC, FPGA, whatever you want, you can put it in there. And also, of course, the network interface card of the system. So now we will follow the path of a packet in the system. So a packet arrives at the NIC, and then it's handled by the networking subsystem, which generates application level requests. Then it passes this to the dispatcher by using a shared memory, which puts them in turn in a global queue. Then, according to some scheduling policy, it assigns them to one of the worker cores for execution. If a request finishes execution normally in a worker core, it can send a reply back out of the system by using, again, the dispatcher and the networking subsystem. But the most interesting thing here is that if the dispatcher identifies that a request is executing for too long on one of the worker cores, it can send an interrupt, put it back in the queue, and put a different request to execute on that same core. And that's the general design of Shinjuku. Okay, so we saw that the dispatcher needs to be able to send interrupts to the worker cores, and we saw in simulation that we need to do that as often as every 5 microseconds to each core in order to achieve microsecond scale tail latency. And now we'll see how we minimize the overheads in order to achieve that. Okay, so we need to minimize both the sender and the receiver overheads. And the sender in our system is always the dispatcher, and the receivers are always the worker cores. And the sender overhead is important because the dispatcher needs to be able to send a large number of interrupts to a large number of worker cores in a short period of time. And also the worker side is important because we want the worker to spend most of its time actually executing application level work instead of just handling interrupts. So if we think of the dispatcher and the workers like normal applications in Linux, the first mechanism that comes to mind is Linux signals, of course. Even though they're less expensive than we expected, they still involve a system call and the kernel. And that's why they have an overhead of more than 2,000 cycles, both at the sender and the receiver side. So the next idea we had was, what if we leverage hardware support for virtualization and we execute both the dispatcher and the worker at the same level as that of a guest operating system? So we move them there, and then we have access to hardware interrupts. But in order to use those, we need to access local hardware on each core that manages interrupts, the APIC. And in order to do that in turn, both the dispatcher and the workers need to suffer a costly VM exit, and that is access to the kernel again. And that's why, because of these VM exits, the overhead is about the same as that of Linux signals, more than 2,000 cycles, both at the sender and the receiver side. So what we want now is to eliminate these two. So on the sender side, we map the APIC to the dispatcher's address space, so we can access the ROM user space, and we eliminate the VM exit there, while on the receiver side, we use a hardware feature that's called posted interrupts to directly inject the interrupts to user space and eliminate the VM exit there as well. So with these two optimizations, we're able to cut down the cost by 85% on the sender side and 52% on the receiver side. And this allows us to have a time quantum as small as 5 microseconds with less than 10% overhead. Okay, so now we have these amazing interrupt capabilities. How can we use them to do effective scheduling? And actually, there are two cases. In the first one, we are not able to distinguish between the different requests that come in the system. Then we cannot do anything very smart, as we put all the requests in a single queue, we interrupt as often as possible, and we place the interrupted request at the back of the queue. The second case is, in the second case, we can identify between the request types. So we can have one queue for each type at the dispatcher and achieve better resolution among the different types. and we still interrupt as often as possible, but we have to answer two additional scheduling questions. The first one is, every time you have an available core, which queue should we select for execution? And the second one is, where should we put an interrupted request? At the header or at the tail of its corresponding queue? And in this talk, I'll focus more on the first question, but I'd be happy to discuss about the second one offline or after this talk. Okay, so we use a very simple queue selection policy where we check only the first request in each queue and then select the one with the highest ratio of the waiting time over the target latency of that request type. And the waiting time here is how much time the request has spent the system so far, both executing and waiting in the queue. And this policy achieves our goals because for the smaller requests, the target latency is initially low, so they are likely to get selected as soon as they enter the system and achieve their small target latencies, while for the longer ones, the ratio will go up as they age and they spend more time in the system, so they will eventually be selected without starvation, achieving their much longer target latencies. And another advantage of this policy is that because we only check the first request in each queue, it's super lightweight. And we need that because the dispatcher needs to make millions of scheduling decisions every second. Okay. So we saw how Shinjuku works in general. Let's see how it performs compared to other similar systems. And we actually compare Shinjuku with two other systems, X and Zygos, which are state-of-the-art specialized data plane operating systems that actually share a large part of the code base and network stack optimizations with Shinjuku. And for all systems, we use 16 logical cores in total. But for Shinjuku, we need to sacrifice two of them, one for the networking subsystem and one for the dispatcher. And we used two workloads to evaluate them. The first one is a busy spin synthetic benchmark that we developed in order to explore a large application space. And the second one is the RocksDB in-memory database developed by Facebook. So we start by a workload that's the best case for X and Zygos. So we use the single queue policy in Shinjuku and the homogeneous exponential workload, which does not need much context switching or load balancing. So it's ideal for the DFCFS architecture that's used by both X and Zygos. So here we see that since Shinjuku has low interrupt overheads and a very efficient implementation of a single queue, it achieves latency similar to X for somehow lower load, even though it has to sacrifice the two cores for the dispatcher and the networking subsystem. And Zygos is actually much worse because work stealing has too high overheads for this single microsecond execution times. However, when we move to a highly variable workload, a RocksDB workload where 99.5% of the requests are gets and 0.5% are scans, and the scans are much longer than the gets here, we see that for X and Zygos, the tail latency is heavily affected by the existence of the scans because of the lack of interrupts, as the gets can get stuck behind the scans. But Shinjuku, on the other hand, can sustain an 80% lower tail latency for 6.6x higher load because exactly these interrupts allow the gets to bypass the much longer scans. So next, we want to see how each of our optimizations affects Shinjuku's performance. And here we have again a mixed scan and get workload. And here we separate the latency of the gets and the scans. So on the left side, we have the latency of the gets, and on the right side, the latency of the scans. And again, the scans are much longer than the gets in the order of a millisecond, and the gets are only 5 microseconds. And initially, we have Shinjuku with a single queue policy without using interrupts, which is basically Shinjuku CFCFS. So if we add interrupts to the mix, we see that the get latency is much flatter and smoother, but because of the additional interrupt overhead, we lose some of the maximum load that we can support. However, if we are able to distinguish between the gets and the scans and use the multi-queue policy in Shinjuku, we do not need to interrupt as often as before, and therefore we recover most of the lost load. Okay, so we have this single dispatcher in the system, and many of you might wonder if that's actually the bottleneck of our system, because it has to do all the scheduling, queuing, all the packets have to go through there. And in this case, we use actually, in order to test the scalability, we use a worst case workload with a fixed 1 microsecond execution time. And here we see that Shinjuku can scale up to 5 million requests per second and 11 physical cores. And actually, in this machine, the 12th core is in a different socket. So if you add a second dispatcher on the other socket, we can scale up to more than 20 cores and 10 million requests per second. Okay. So we have many more details in our NSDI paper. We show how we implement very fast context switching in user space, network scaling, more things about the scheduling policy, and more extensive performance analysis with more workloads. But in order to implement Shinjuku, we had to work around and sometimes even against the hardware. So these are some hardware changes that will make our lives much easier and let Shinjuku be actually usable in many deployments. So first if we had access to user-level interrupts, we wouldn't need to use the virtualization extensions to implement very fast interrupts in user space. If we want to offload the scheduling and the dispatcher on the NIC, we need some kind of very low latency interconnect between the NIC and the host, like QPI or something like that. And also the last one is like an architecture thing, because we have to poll a lot of time on shared memory locations. We could avoid that by using hardware core-to-core message queues. But to conclude, we saw that for low tail latency, for general workloads, we need to have scheduling with interrupts, single queue, and flexible scheduling policies. And Shinjuku is able to meet all of these demands at microsecond scale by implementing a scalable queue by using a dedicated core, by interrupting as often as every 5 microseconds, and by making scheduling decisions based on the target latency of the applications. And it's also open source, so you can use it. You can find it on GitHub. Thank you very much. And yeah, I'm happy to hear any questions. Microphone.
Thank you. Can you go back to the slide with lessons for hardware?
Yeah.
So you're saying that you want to do some scheduling in the NIC itself.
Yeah.
What kind of traffic are you having with you
ideally
in your system?
Ideally, we'd like to terminate all the connections on the NIC, and then to be able to send the application level request to cores for execution.
Are those TCP requests?
For now, it's UDP, but eventually we'd like to be TCP, quick, anything, yeah.
Well, for UDP requests, you can define a header format that, if it's constant enough, though not very complicated, the NIC could pulse the header that you define. You can define header formats, the packet format the application level protocol you're using, and you can allow the NIC to do scheduling or stealing to a call according to to some data in that packet, and maybe it would answer your need.
Yeah, for TCP is much harder because of the...
For TCP, in certain cases, this is possible, but yes, it's much harder.
I agree.
Totally. You can look at the work we did with TLS for TCP. It's an example.
Okay. Thank you.
Any other questions? Because I have a few, but before...
For a type of workload that multiplex a lot of frames encrypted onto the same connection, like H2, Quick, you really need the user space to tell you what are the pieces of work.
Yeah.
So to make this more generic, what do you, what are your plans to support that type of workload?
Yeah, so for now, this mostly targeted to data center workloads. So the whole machine and the client and everything should belong on the same, like to the same entity, so we do not have these issues. But I don't have a very good answer for your question. We haven't thought yet how to handle a TLS and this kind of encryption.
Even for data center workloads, because we have RPCs and they're usually framed, I can send you one large copy and then one small request or health checks. That
yeah,
that is what they're aiming for. That's what their scan is. So encryption will have its own problems.
Yeah.
So I had a question for each of these.
Okay.
So your group of 12, assumed everybody can get, every core accesses memory at the same distance, right? So it was a single socket system?
The 16 cores, yeah.
Yeah, it's a single socket system.
You mean the, this?
No, even your, if you have
there are 12 physical cores in the socket. And
Because if you have a deep memory, if a NUMA hierarchy, you will have, that design won't work.
Yeah.
Like you'll have problems. So first. Second, you said it doesn't work as well as RSS, but what I wanted to see was how would pure RSS, using your scheme, no scheduling, but RSS distribution, right, a toplets distribution, how well or how poorly does it do?
RSS is basically what X is doing. And it's very likely that there are imbalances.
So, okay, I see. So statistical imbalance is the risk.
Yeah, and because we care about the tail latency in this case and not the average case, it's very important.
So you're saying you get an unbounded tail. You'll probably get a pretty good median, but you'll get an unbounded tail. Okay, so good answer. And the third question was about the messaging between cores. Why wasn't event FD and IPI enough? I mean, IPI is exactly what you're talking about.
No, like I said, shows something that does not interrupt the execution of the other core. So it just
You want a message.
Interrupt.
I see. So you... No, but you also... Sometimes you want
to need interrupts and messages.
I see.
The messages are to pass the pointers around, and the interrupts are to notify that we need like a change.
On
the context that's executed.
You want a conditional implementation of event FD that sometimes will become an IPI, sometimes it's just a message into a queue. Okay. I think...
Yeah, this is like...
So all of this should be doable in Linux itself. I mean, there's no reason why this is not... I'm looking at Eric mostly, right? I mean, this sounds like we should... They shouldn't need a user space implementation. And I think we can do this with current NICs. I don't think we need a lot of very exotic things, as was
mentioned.
So
only the PCI interconnect is like the latency is quite high to schedule each individual request from the NIC to the...
Correct. So you can't do it that way. It has to be that then something on the other side of the PCI is going to do effectively send messages into processor cores, right? I mean, that's doable as well.
Or
it's
we could
PCI
have
right.
like a QPI NIC, like...
That's a much
on
bigger
chip,
ask.
Yeah.
You'll fix the latency problem, but you'll kill the software stack. Okay, any more questions? Yeah.
I saw in the GitHub page that you have activated the huge pages. That makes the packets to be constantly received by the same... CPU, okay? I mean, this typically for...
Yeah, we do that anyway.
Sorry?
Because all the packets are going to the network subsystem, which is in a single CPU, so
So this is for a specific type of traffic, I mean, where you don't have this kind of dispersed traffic that goes to different CPUs from...
So no, no, we direct the whole traffic to a single CPU on purpose.
So that means that those figures are the best you can have. That's not typical of like the average metrics. I mean, this is not typical for a scheduling. I mean, typically in a very high, a large number of cores and applications, packets go to different CPUs. It's not typical to have.
They're not actually executed on that CPU. They arrive at. They're only directed to other CPUs for execution. So it's only like a pass through mechanism.
That is what the answer to your question is the paper. They are explicitly scheduling to a core. So there is no distribution underneath them. They manage the distribution.
Yeah.
There's a hand up there somewhere now. Okay, everyone's ducking. We are over time, so thank you.
Thank you very much.